Toria K. Where's Toria? I think Toria was going to do the welcome for us. Did everybody get a copy of an agenda?
Nope.
Yeah.
Nope.
Hey, John.
Okay, back to you.
How are you?
What do you want us to do?
Great. All right, I'll get that to you. Good afternoon. Thank you, everybody, for taking the time out of your busy schedule to join us for County Gov 101. This is something new we're trying in recognition of county government. I'm Tori Frank. I'm the county clerk. And this is our county manager, Craig Honeycutt. And what we'd just like to do, real brief, if you don't mind just going around the room, giving us your name and maybe just tell us what your interests are or what brought you here today, if you don't mind. We'll start with this row.
I'm John Brooks, and I've been here since 1978. And I'm just interested in bringing more government back to our cities and counties instead of states and federal.
I'm Caitlin Bobakios Bateson. I work at Allied Churches, and so food security and food policy is kind of my thing.
My name is Kim Crawford. I'm the director at Allied Churches, and I can say her name. As the director of the largest and only shelter, soup kitchen, and food pantry of its kind, serving the entire county. This is vitally important to us.
I'm Bill Miller. I'm with the Swepsonville Town Council. We're the town with the blinking light down the road. And I'm also the chairman of the Alamance County Planning Committee for Services to the Elder. And I'm here to learn how to tweak the county.
My name is David Abul. I'm on the Social Service Board of Alamance County. I'm also on the Water Conservation Board of Alamance County. I'm trying to learn something about the budget. That's what I'm here today.
My name is Tony Cox. I'm just a private citizen. I'm just trying to learn more about government.
I'm Gene Brooks. I had that better to do today. Now, I just want to learn more about the local government, how stuff's done.
My name is Andy Stevens. I'm relocating from Greensboro-Guilford County, where I'm a regular attendee of their county functions. A couple of them are probably glad to see me move.
I bet ours are more fun.
I'm John Haynes. I'm just a private citizen. I realize that we have a lot more control over who's in charge of our local government than our national government.
I'm Jeff Andrews. I'm an attorney, and I'm involved in some civic organizations, and I just want to learn more about what's going on.
Yeah. Rhonda Peebles. I've been a resident of Alamance County since 1987. I enjoy learning. I'm a retired teacher.
Oh, wow. I'm Alice Reyes. I was born in the county, and I live in Burlington now. Since I'm married a city boy, and I thought I'd move in with him. So I'm still living in that house, and it's too much trouble to move in. Anyway, I'm interested in learning things, still interested in learning, and there's always something to learn, and I thought I'd like to see what was on for today.
Carl Mansfield, resident of Alamance County for 81 years. Just want to see what's happening.
Okay. The
This is Commissioner Bob Bird.
I'm Bob Bird. I'm a county commissioner. I'm in my first term, second year of my first term as county commissioner. And I'm here because we have an expert in our county manager about county government. He teaches it. He's been a county manager here and other places for many years, and he was very active in the North Carolina. I'm the board of directors of the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. I'm the county manager professional group, and incoming chairman, I believe.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to come, even though I'm already part of county government, there's always something I can learn, and I want to hear what kinds of feedback and questions that you all have.
I'm Barbara Bird. I'm a longtime resident of, I was born and grew up in Graham, so I'm a local. I am interested in learning more about county government, and I'm here.
Because you don't hear it enough when he comes home, right?
Libby Hodges, I work with the planning department here for the county. I'm just here to listen.
I'll turn it over to Craig.
Well, thank you. And again, we really do appreciate everybody being here, and I appreciate the work that Tori has done to do this. This is something we've talked about for a couple of years now. This is our first foray into County Government 101. A lot of communities will do this over a week process or a 10-session class, and we've not gotten to that point yet, so we thought we would kind of dip our big toe in the water and get a little feedback and see what was interesting, what was not interesting, and what we can do. But again, we're excited that you're here, and we're thankful that you're here as well. One of the things we're going to do is we're first going to talk about the county and really a lot about what services that we provide and really give you a lot of raw numbers. So sometimes when you think about, well, is it Department of Social Services, what do they do? When you look at the raw numbers of actually the people that they affect, then it starts hitting you a little bit more. Or if you look at the library, the number of library books and programs and activities we have. And, you know, when we talk about our public library, we have four branches, and we have one in Nevin and Graham and Burlington and North Park. But really looking at the raw numbers is like, wow, there's a lot of people that take advantages of a lot of the services that we provide here in Alamance County. So to start with, let's just get a little bit of information. And one of the things that we will do, if you go to our website, alamancefnc.com, this presentation, the budget presentation, will be online this afternoon. So that way you don't have to worry about taking notes. It'll be ready for you and you can access it at any time. Right now, our population, and please stop me at any time if you have a question or a comment or something that would be really valuable for our discussion. Our population right now is 158,000. We are the 17th most populous county within the state of North Carolina. We have had over 15% growth rate in the past 10 years. So we're in a growing community. You know, that we used to be called, Jeff, what was our motto with the chamber?
The Carolina Corridor.
The Carolina Corridor, because we had 40 and 85 running right for us. So we are a very transit community, but we're also very centrally located. So we're getting a lot of growth, and we'll see that. Yes?
What is the projected growth?
The projected growth is a great question. I don't know, but it was on the census page, and I forgot to copy it down.
Okay.
But again, we're the 17th most populated. We used to be 18th, now we've moved up to 17th. Here's our basic demographic information. Right at 430 square miles, our poverty rate is almost 18%, which is a little bit higher than the North Carolina rate. Persons per square mile, we're a little bit denser than other areas within the state. The median household income is 45,000, and our housing units are 68,000.
What size is that household? Four?
I could not tell you. But that includes apartments and single families.
No, the median household income, is that for a family of four?
Yes, that's for a family of four, I'm sorry, yes. When we talked about Alamance County, one of the things we need to look at here are who are our employers? Who are our largest employers within the county? And these are our top employers, starting with the school system and LabCorp, then the hospital, then the university, Walmart, and then you talk about Alamance County government. So we are in the top six of, or is that seven? Wait, one, two, three, four, five. We're top six of employers as far as size within the county. Then Burlington, GKN, and ACC is a community college. So those are the largest employers. Well, who are our largest taxpayers? Or, wait a minute, let's go here. Who are our largest taxpayers? Valuation-wise, number one is LabCorp. They currently own property, personal and real property within Alamance County, valued at $176.8 million. And again, if we break that down to the taxes that they pay at 58 cents per hundred, that's over $1 million that they pay to the county in just property taxes. That doesn't include Burlington or Graham or any other fire district tax. That's just taxes that they pay to the county. Duke Energy is next, GKN, Honda Power and Equipment, Buckner Steel, and then Alamance Crossings. So again, all those are valued in the millions.
That's not what they pay.
No, that's the valuation.
Property value.
Right, yes. Like I said, on LabCorp, they pay taxes a little bit over $1 million. Alright, let's get back. Alright, one of the things that we always hear about is what's our tax rate? So, is it too high, too low, where does it need to be? And so what I did is look at the past 11 years, and that includes reval, which we will have coming up not this year, but next year. Through the past 11 years, our tax rate has ranged anywhere from 52 cents to 58 cents. And again, 2009-10 was the first year of reval. So usually you try to go revenue neutral. So usually during a reval year, your valuations go up. So your taxes go down to kind of give you a zero-sum game on revenue. Problem we had during that year, though, is we had a lot of appeals on reevaluation. We had 18,000 appeals on property reevaluation. So our valuations went, instead of revenue neutral, it went revenue in the hole. But that's kind of a snapshot of where we're at on our taxes.
Craig, does that mean that when you do revaluation, are you going to factor in that there may be a lot of appeals?
We did. We factored in at the time about 5% appeals, not realizing it was as messed up as it was at 18,000 appeals. But we did factor in.
So the upcoming one, are you going to change that percentage because of the history from the last time?
It depends. We have a very, very, very good tax administrator now, Jeremy Atkins, and we're doing a lot of things internally that I'm excited that Jeremy has a very good handle. We've added on some additional staff. We've put some money aside for our internal revaluation staff. We have a better handle now than we did contracting it out. So we're hoping, that we will have a much better revaluation than we had 8 years ago. So I think we're the first ones to admit it was a mess. It was an absolute teetotal mess.
When you're looking at reevaluations, where do you pick the number from?
It's market value.
If I come in with an appraisal of my house that says one thing, and yours says this number, which number do you go with?
You would want to go with, if yours is higher, you want to bring it back to me. It's supposed to be at 100%. But that's what through the appeal process.
Okay.
So if you have a house and we have valued it at $175,000, and you have appraisers and comps that says it's only valued at 150, you bring that in and appeal that valuation and go to the Board of Equalization and Review, and you can get that lower. Any other questions on the evaluation? Again, I don't want to skip anything or go too fast. Yes, sir.
Greg, I'd like to go back.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
But I should have thought of it sooner. I'm kind of slow. You listed the largest employers mm-hmm. and their contribution, or we could kind of calculate. Mm-hmm. Then I would suggest there's a category that we'd all like to see. What do the individual property owners contribute? And then also small businesses. Mm-hmm. You know, I guess that, for example, Sheets Distribution Center mm-hmm. and their gas stations, or whatever you call them, is a small business compared to LabCorp and the others. But, you know, some other time maybe we could look at what they...
So are you looking for like a pie chart that showed how much large, how much small, how much residential?
A breakdown of industrial, commercial, and residential?
Something like, not industrial or commercial, but by the size that you did there.
Probably there's a way to do that. There probably is a way to do that.
Craig, one other question about this. Is that just full-time employees, or does it include full-time equivalents?
It's full-time equivalent. It's full-time equivalent. So if we average out what that tax rate has been over the last 11 years, it is averaged out to almost 55 cents. So we're at 58 cents now, so we're kind of in the ballpark of where we have been historically over the last 11 years. And again, for every one penny of taxes that we raise or lower, that's $1.2 million in actual dollars that we get. Any questions on that?
Well, that was a pretty substantial increase from last year to this then, if you went to 58 cents from 53 or 54, whatever it was.
We did, but we also increased our school funding by about $4 million. We implemented a pay class study. We bought capital that we were not purchasing over the last few years. So we played a lot of catch up last year. We really did. Yes, sir.
So that's county commissioners that make the decision.
Yes, sir.
On what that tax rate is.
Yes, sir.
And let's say that you've got commissioners that just do not want to raise it at all, and you're in a crunch.
Yes, sir. The board, what, and we'll go over the budget as well. I've got a whole thing about the budget and where we get our money and that type of thing. In the process, but what my responsibility is as county manager is I serve as a budget officer. So I'm supposed to give the board of commissioners a budget that I think, in my professional opinion, is what's the right thing based on tax rate, based on needs of the schools, based on needs of our employees, based on facility issues, based on emergency management, based on EMS, sheriff's department. So I'm supposed to formulate that budget. And then once I give it to the Board of Commissioners, it's up to the board to say, you put too much money here, you didn't put enough money here, you need to adjust the tax rate, or you don't need to adjust the tax rate. So they get the final say-so, but it's based upon starting with the manager's recommended budget.
What's the percentage of the school budget, of the county budget right now?
I think it's 36, but I've got that slide coming up. So, but it's around 36%, but I think that also includes the community college. So, all right, we put there. Here is a great place if you're interested and you can't get no-dos, that is a really good website. NCACC is the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, State of the County. If you go to that link, you can do some comparisons. You can list three counties and compare a lot of different things. So you compare tax rates, you compare housing, you compare median income. So a lot of different things that you can look at to compare at the website. But also, if you look at it, what they have on the website is the average tax rate for all counties, and that's all 100 of us, is almost 61 cents. And again, we're at 58 cents. And they've also even broken it down for the counties in the Piedmont. The counties in the Piedmont are averaging about 71 cents, with a range from 46.5 to 92.5. So I think at 92.5 is Orange County. Then there's also average rates by county tier designation. Tier 1 is your poor counties. Tier 1 are the counties that are very economically distressed and have issues. Tier 2s are kind of, you're okay. You know, you're kind of medium, you're average. And then Tier 3s are really your upper income counties like Wake and Mecklenburg and Buncombe County, those that have a lot of economic development, those that have a lot of growth. So again, we're a Tier 2 county. The average for Tier 2 counties tax rate is 64.77, and again, we're at 58. So overall, we are fairly competitive with what our tax rate is. But again, one of the things I want to show you is, in the next few slides, what are you getting with your tax dollars? What are you doing with your tax dollars? What services are we providing? So that's one of the reasons I'm glad we're able to do this class today.
Craig, can I ask you a question? Just relatively, are there the most Tier 2 counties, and then do the Tier 1s and the Tier 3s, are there about the same number of those, or do you know how that breaks down?
I do not know the breakdown. It fluctuates. It really does fluctuate. It depends upon income, and there's a certain formula that the state has. There's some counties that will move up and some counties that will move down. So they reevaluate that on an annual basis. I don't think it's a set amount of counties.
And I didn't expect that. I just meant relatively. I would assume that the average would be the largest of the groups.
Right.
And then I just wondered if the poor and the rich were about the same numbers.
Yeah. We can check on that. We have to check on that. All right, here's an organizational chart of Alamance County. Let me see if this corner works. All right, it starts with the citizens. We always start with the citizens. That's who our bosses are. That's who my big boss, Mr. Bird's boss is the citizens of Alamance County, because you're the ones that vote, you're the ones that elect. And if you like them, you vote for them. If you don't like them, you don't vote for them. But we start, after the citizens come the Board of Commissioners, and then we have two elected positions within the county. We have the elected sheriff, and then we have the elected registered deeds in Hugh Webster. And again, they're part of county government, but they're elected, so they don't fall under the county's personnel policy. The Sheriff's Department acts really as their own agency. The Registered Deed acts as their own agency. They're the boss, not the county administrator or county manager, me, nor the Board of Commissioners. We control their budget and their facilities. They kind of do their own thing. Next is you have the appointed people who work staffed, who are appointed by the Board of Commissioners. You have our tax administrator, Jeremy Akins, our county attorney, Clyde Albright, myself as county manager, and our county clerk, Tori Frank. And then off from this, in the dotted line, we have social services, health, elections, soil and water conservation, and cooperative extension. They are part of the county, but not part of the county, if that makes sense again. Our social services, they kind of operate as their own independent authority. Mr. Spruill sits on that board. Craig Honeycutt, as a county manager, cannot hire or fire the social services director. Mr. Spruill, though, as sitting on that board as the social services, has that authority. Our responsibility as a county is we fund, they are county employees, they use county equipment with our from MIS, which is Management Information Systems. We are tied together, but governing-wise, they are not direct reports to county management. Same thing with the health department, with Stacy Solomons. Stacy is a department, but she reports to a health board. Does not report directly to the county manager, nor to the board of commissioners. So Commissioner Burke cannot fire Stacy. Well, you're on the health board, but so he does sit on the health board. So he can. Commissioner,
only one vote.
But Commissioner Boswell cannot. So, yes, sir.
Many counties are moving to merge those two together. Is there any thought of that happening in Alamance?
We looked at that a couple of years ago. It was one of those issues. Was there really a lot of savings? And also, did the Board of Commissioners really want to serve in that role? Because it's a lot of work to serve as a health department board. It is a lot of work to serve as social services. Did the Board of Commissioners really want to take on those added duties? And at the time we talked about it, we thought we did, and then we decided we didn't. So, but again, then we have our soil and water and cooperative extension. They're really part of state government, but we do house them. But then here are the departments that are underneath that are direct reports to the county manager and the assistant county manager. Assistant County Manager Brian Haygood. Brian does an absolutely wonderful job. Used to be Recreation Director, if you know Brian. But Brian is responsible at direct reports for these departments over here, and these over here are direct reports to me. And now we'll kind of go through and see what we do do. Sorry about that. Alright. Here's what I do, and Brian and Tori in county management. We're responsible for the day-to-day operations of the county. Board of Commissioners who sit here make policy. They give me my direction. If they say we want to do X, Y, and Z, then it's my job to make sure X, Y, and Z is done. If I make recommendations to them, but they can go, no, I don't like it. They don't like it, not a big deal. But they set the policy, they set what my direction is, they approve the budget, they approve of the ordinances. Not me, but I implement. In working with the department heads and working with outside agencies, that's the responsibility of the county manager. And again, commissioners make policy, county management, we implement policies. So we also, as we talked earlier, management makes budget recommendations. It is a manager's recommended budget that the board will look at and debate. But one of the biggest things that I do is I work with a lot of different agencies. Work with Town of Swepsonville, work with City of Burlington. We're talking animal control right now, animal shelters right now. We're having to talk with the state about the animal control shelter. We're talking with, we work with Kim and Allied Churches. You name it, we work with them. Government does not govern in a vacuum. We are dependent upon our partners. We need our partners. We want our partners. We love our partners. Because if it weren't for the partners, from a hospital to you name it, we couldn't get anything done. But also, I serve as the liaison for economic development. So I kind of work with our chamber and Mac Williams with respect to economic development that occurs within the county. Again, if you have any questions, just jump right in.
Craig.
Yes, sir.
Would you go back to the other, to the slide right? Yeah. Now, you said that the county commissioners were talking about taking those appointed department head positions, at least considering taking those and bringing them into the organizational chart.
Right.
Now, I assume that each of those that came in would have to agree to that. You couldn't make that decision unilaterally, could you?
We could make that decision unilaterally.
Okay.
Right now, it would only be for social services and health. Elections would still stay separate. I forgot to mention Kathy and elections. How can you forget elections when all the election stuff we have now? But again, Kathy Holland, who's our elections chair, she has a separate board that she reports directly to.
And is that statutory?
That's statutory, yes. But again, only a couple of years ago did the statutes give the counties the authority to combine and put social services and health directly under county government.
That put them like the library and human resources and all of that, right?
Right, okay. Sure, but. Mm-hmm. All right. Whoops, let me go the wrong way. All right. I like to say being county manager is like herding cats. You know, anybody ever tried to herd cats? We deal with a lot of different people. There's 20-some departments. There's outside agencies. There's outside board. You name it, we deal with. So it is really like herding cats. So if sometimes one of the cats get loose, it's not because we're not trying to herd them. But it's fun. It really is. I really enjoy what I do. All right. Let's talk individual departments. That should be 450,000 visitors per year at county parks. And this is all county parks. We have almost 1,500 youth sports participants and 889 games. We are very committed to Special Olympics here in the county.
We were the first county in North Carolina to have Special Olympics in 1970.
Yep.
Before Wake or Mecklenburg or anything.
We have such, and I'm very, very proud of our recreation department and the work they do with Special Olympics. Very committed. It is a year-round process to make sure that runs right. But again, they are also looking for grants from trails to parkland. We just got a grant to expand Cedar Rock Park. And as much as we can use somebody else's money and not county tax dollars, that's the goal that we have. But again, I'm giving you snapshots. This is not everything they do. This is trying to just kind of hit some snapshot. Again, 1,041 acres of property includes properties and trail easements, and we are huge into trails. Anybody ever hiked the trail at Cedar Rock Park or the Mountain to the Sea Trail? We love the Hall River Trail. If you've not been on the Hall River Trail, please go on the Hall River Trail. It is an incredible asset that we do have here in the county. So we do a lot with trails, we do a lot with recreation, we do a lot. And again, we have to have people, equipment to maintain the, you know, over 1,000 acres of property and trails. So that's part of where your tax dollars go. Library. Over 500,000 citizens visit Alamance County Public Libraries. Maybe multiple. I hope they're multiple times. No, they are multiple times. So that's just total visits. Almost 800 items were checked out. Again, we partner with everybody. And that's something I'm very proud of, what we do in the county. Again, we don't work in a vacuum. We partner with people to try to make sure we provide services. So I won't bore you with all those. We'll read that. And then here's economic development. Alamance County Chamber serves as our lead agency. Also, as part of that, Burlington, Mevin, Graham, Elon, and the Village of Alamance contribute to that funding of the position for economic development. This is since 2012. 25 new and expanding industries have happened within Alamance County. 1,800 new jobs and over $400 million in capital investment. That's huge. If you just think about Walmart. Walmart was $85 million and 438 jobs. That would be good for 1 year. We added on Wiley as well, which was about $120 million and about 200 jobs. So we have done a really good job. I think we've positioned ourselves very, very well for capital investment and job creation. This was just announced. Alamance County is the ninth nationally for the number of economic development projects in 2015 for metro areas under 200,000 population. That's huge. That's a wonderful statistic. And again, there's been a lot of hard work with the Chamber, Mac Williams, and also the partnerships that we do have with our municipalities. Burlington and Mevin and Graham have been just absolutely wonderful to work with. All right, one of the things I did want to talk about a little bit is incentives. Everybody has got an opinion one way or the other on incentives. Either you're for it or you're getting it. So, think about incentives. If you want to play in the game, you basically have to pay. It's not that you Walmart is needing the incentive to come, but they want to be shown a little bit of love. Everybody likes to be shown a little bit of love. Everybody wants you to come to their community. They want you to support them and say, hey, if you don't give it to me, I can go somewhere else. So it's all about showing the love. But what I did was kind of look at just an average of kind of what we look at when we are doing economic incentives. Just picked a company. Let's say that we had an $8 million company coming in that's new taxable. It doesn't include soft costs. That doesn't include land costs. This is new taxable income that we can add on to our tax books. You know, a lot of times they say, well, the engineering cost was this, and the real estate cost was... No. This is tax. We want this on the books. So if a company's coming in with $8 million worth of new taxable income and 30 jobs, which is a pretty good rent for us. So we would usually look at about a 1.5% investment. And that would be based upon their taxable capital. So 1.5% of $8 million is $120,000. And that's the max we will pay. So there's a lot of companies that come in and say, hey, we want to put in $8 million here, and it ends up being $10 million. We don't give them incentive on the additional $2 million. We only cap it off at our agreement of $8 million. They come in less, we claw back. But again, that's usually paid over a five-year period. So if you divide $120,000 by five, that's $24,000 a year annual that will pay a company as an incentive. But again, we check to make sure that their tax valuation and their job numbers do not go down. If they go down, we don't pay, or we pay a reduced rate.
And when you say pay, I want to get this straight. You hand them a check, or you transfer money. It's not a deduction in their tax.
They have to pay their taxes first. But we do give them a check. So once they pay their taxes, we'll go back and check to see if the investment and the job numbers are meeting what the agreement said. Yes.
Are those agreements and documentation public record?
Yes.
Because many other counties have difficulty providing the fact that their incentives actually pay out because they can't keep track of it.
We are very, very, very tight on we can show you every incentive we've done. Yes, sir.
And that's not including infrastructure, correct? Water, sewer, utilities, roads.
Now that we did for Walmart and Lidl. That is part of that document. But the water and sewer for Lidl and Walmart were separate because part of that was they were looking to expand in that area anyway. And they'll also get revenue off the water and sewer. So really our agreement with Lytle and Walmart was really for the land. But it's all spelled out in the agreement.
Okay, but the county does not own the utilities, the water, the sewer.
Right, Mevin or Graham does.
Okay.
We help pay because we put $1 million in on the Lytle and Walmart agreement because the numbers didn't work. So we were trying to help them out because we wanted them so bad. The long-term benefits are going to be, you know, they'll pay for itself within a five-year period. So we're pay to play, and there was that expectation that if they were going to build there, they would have water and sewer. So we had to bring them water and sewer. So. I hope did I answer?
Oh, yes.
Oh, okay. If I didn't.
Well, the problem I have with it is you've got companies that have been here 10, 15, 20 years that have been expanded, expanded, and expanded. And when they come and want something, it's like, you know, and there's areas of the county that there's not commercial, that the county don't act like they even care about. In the utility section, the infrastructure and stuff like that, you know, nobody, you're giving them $1 million. There's $1 million you could use somewhere else to help more people rather than one business. It's what I was, you know, it's in my head. That's why I had to go look at my
head. And that's true, but on the flip side of that is $200 million in new capital investment and over 600 jobs. So it's kind of, you do have to make those tough decisions. You really do. But I'll also say, if there is a company out here, our threshold for incentives to consider, I think, is 10 jobs and $3 million. So if somebody is doing an expansion over an existing industry, we will consider that as well. So
you did the Kaiser Roth.
Yeah, we did Kaiser Roth. Yeah.
But in the last incentives, the language changed over here at the Hanford Brickyard Road. There was no guarantee of jobs.
There, with Hanford, they could not guarantee it up front. But once they do, they're not consolidating any of their existing, or Alamance Foods is not consolidating any of their existing buildings there. There's been a natural job creation there.
But I'm just saying the language changed, and there was even discussion with that language change.
Yes. But again, if we look at $8 million of new taxable investment, the taxes on that is $46,400. So we have a $22,400 positive cash flow because of the investment that we made and the company made within Alamance County. At the end of the 5 years, at year six, we get the full $46,000.
About the taxes, do they make that $46,400? Do they pay them once, all at once, or do they break it down? Do y'all have to break it down?
They pay all at once.
Okay.
At all at once. But again, we do, even though we pay it over a five-year period, we're in the black during that five-year period. And then also, at the end of it, we get the full. If we didn't try to do incentives, then we would not, we probably wouldn't have gotten anything. Yes?
Just, there's a spelling, there's a misspelling there that you may want to correct before you keep throwing that up. That last one, the spelling of receives, you've got the I on the wrong side of
okay.
The
V. All right. Spelling was never my strong
suit.
All right. Here's Veteran Services. We do have a Veteran Services office, which is right across the street and in our Court Services building. We have a population of over 12,000 veterans within Alamance County. We help them walk through the veteran and the VA and the benefits that they need claimed. So it is a maze. But we do have two VA officers over there, and they do serve our veterans.
Do they work for the VA?
No, they work for the county. We're an agent.
Is it reimbursed by the VA?
Not at all. It's a service we provide. They do provide some training. They do help us with some certifications, yeah. But it's a county employee, a county department, and a county service.
Do all the counties do that?
Most do. Most do. Here's the Department of Social Services. One of the things that we're going to do at our Thursday meeting, we're going to have our social services director, Kelly Inman, the social services will be here, also our health department director will be here, the sheriff will be here. Who else did I have in the list?
Strategic plan.
Libby's going to update on strategic plan. So our larger departments who really do a lot of touching of citizens, I'm going to get them to do their own presentation. So this is just kind of hopefully the grand overview. And that if you come back Thursday, you'll get a lot more detail on what the Department of Social Services does. Then we have EMS. We have 8 trucks. We have about 34,000 calls a year that we provide. Not all of them are transports, but 34,000 times EMS is dispatched within Alamance County. Again, up from about double or more than, or 50% more, 60% more than what we were in 2014.
Do you have an estimate about what one of those trucks cost of the EMS?
$150,000. We can get about 200,000 miles. If we do, we can get it remounted, but you can only do that a couple of times. Yes, sir.
Is it not self-supporting or partially self-supporting?
No, sir.
Being like that, all been pretty well self-supporting.
Most of what we charge is the Medicaid rate. We don't have a bill higher than the Medicaid rate, so your insurance company would get paid or bill what we bill Medicaid. We subsidize EMS by about $1 million a year. So.
And I got one other question. What's the tax base value of the county now?
Oh my gosh.
$14 billion?
Could be $14 billion. I'll have to check, but I think if I remember, it was around $14 billion.
Isn't it growing at a tremendous rate?
Not tremendous. I've got some pictures, or I got some slide on inspections. It's starting to pick up. It is starting to pick up, but you have to remember, we just came through the recession. One of the things that I showed the board the other day was, if you look at our sales tax numbers, and everybody said, oh, your sales tax numbers are growing, and they're growing. We're not even at the pre-recession levels of sales tax yet. So in 2006, we collected about $26 million in sales tax. In 2015, we collected $25 million. So, yes, sir.
I was just looking at the budget that we adopted last June, and it says that the tax base has a valuation of about $12.7 billion.
Yeah. I was close, though. But again, we have over 100 full-time employees. We have 8 trucks and 8 crews that are out on the road at all times. Yes, ma'am.
Does the EMS department have, and can they provide a demographic breakdown of where the major calls are and what type?
Probably through the CCOM they can for our CAD system.
Thank you. Craig, on that sales tax revenue, was there any change in the tax rate at all? So that's just taxable sales who still haven't come up.
Right. And a lot of the growth that we think we've seen from that is from Tanker and Alamance Crossing. We'll probably look at a 5 or 6% growth this year. But again, not even the same rate it was in 2006 yet. So when they talk about recession, it was a deep, deep recession. Especially here in Alamance County. But that's EMS. This is Fire Marshal. We have a Fire Marshal Emergency Management Department. Fire Marshal serves as a liaison. We have 13 volunteer fire districts that we tax. That's based upon what the districts want. But we also do fire service training, fire investigations, and enforce the state fire code. Then we have a SARA planner, which is a chemical planner, which we work with, and they support. Well, basically, we have to know where the chemicals are in our county. If we have a huge fire like they did in Apex, and there's at a chemical plant, we need to know what they have on site. So we have a chemical planner, and that's basically all they do is to work with those companies that have chemicals.
Well, we got LabCorp.
We got LabCorp. There's multiple everywhere.
In the county, how many such facilities?
Don't know. I can probably get that number, but off the top of my head, don't know. Again, responsible for upkeep of county NICSL program, and I'll pull after the next slide if you click on the NICSL. We do 701 fire inspections, hazmat emergency responses 22, 701 just general inspections, that includes tents, those type things that require the fire marshal approval, and again we just hired an emergency management position. Tori, if you'll click on NICSL, if you've not signed up for NICSL, I would strongly encourage you to. This is something that the county provides, so if you have weather alerts, any emergency type situation that may occur, you can get an automatic text, you can get a phone call, you can get an email. This will help you in the case of emergency. So I think there's four different ways that you can get reached. But again, when we had the big crash on 40, we sent out a mixed response. Stay away from 40, 110 cars are crashed on 40. So it's a wonderful system. If you've ever got the robocalls from schools, this is kind of like the robocalls for emergency management. But again, would encourage you to sign up for that. Helps with snow alerts.
Does that say when you guys are closed?
It also says when we're closed as well. Oh yeah, we've got a sheet up here as well, a handout that you can take back with you about NICSL. But again, we'd strongly encourage you to visit the site and to sign up if you haven't already. All right. Inspections, county does our own inspections, a couple of projects that we're doing. Here's some interesting numbers. We talked about growth. Residential permits are up, but you have to remember they fell. We were in a deep recession, so we had negatives for a bunch of years. But now they're increasing. Total number of permits are up. But again, construction costs are up $109 million to $109 million. So we're pulling out of it. But again, you have to remember where we were pulling it out from. When we did planning, this is all the things that Libby does and Libby's responsible for. Strategic planning process, which she'll talk about on Thursday. These are the code enforcement ordinances that she's responsible for enforcing. Also, we do an abandoned mobile home removal grant program. If you've got an old mobile home that needs to be removed off your property and it's an eyesore and it's a health hazard, we can take care of that for you.
That's through a state grant.
Through a state grant, that's right. We like state grants. But a lot of different things that planning is responsible for. She also does Historic Properties Commission. And then also we have Management Information System. These are 892 PCs, 279 laptops, 110 tablets, 350 cell phones that our MIS department supports, service, and secures. So one of the good things is that we can stay connected. One of the bad things is we stay connected all the time. But again, they're responsible for all the internal wiring, for our broadband, for our wireless. Disaster, if when we had our servers go down, they're responsible to make sure that we didn't lose any information. We did at the time, but now we've got some redundancy that we didn't have before.
Does those numbers include the Sheriff's Department and the Register of Deeds?
Yes, sir. But again, in dealing with that, going back to the Sheriff's Department, we had to have CJIS, HIPAA, all this training. If we're going to be on their system and their network, we have to have that same training. So then we have maintenance. This is a big issue for us right now. We have over 38 buildings in Alamance County. Some good, some not so good. But 58,000 square feet of heated floor space. The interesting thing about the county is we have nonprofits, we have courts, and we also have county departments. So we have a whole kaleidoscope of people who use our facilities. Statutorily, we have to provide space for our parole division with the state. So we're responsible for probation and parole. We're responsible for the courts. So the courthouse that was renovated a couple of years ago, the $3.4 million, that was all a county expenditure. When we renovated the civil courts here, so any new construction of jails, courthouses, those type things are a county responsibility. And then we do have some nonprofits that we do. Oversight of janitorial services, and also, you may not think it's a big thing, we don't want to get sued, so ice removal is huge. So we don't want somebody coming in, tax department, or walking into the social services and slip and fall, so ice removal is huge. Again, human resources. We have 968 plus full-time equivalent employees, over 100 part-time. We average about 140 openings a year. So when you have 140 openings, you got to take applications. So we had almost 3,000 applications received for those 140 jobs. But they also do our employee personnel policy and also help us distribute our benefits. We've got legal, contract review, employment litigation, potential litigation, foreclosures for unpaid taxes. Our legal department also serves as staff for the Department of Social Services, or all departments except for social services, but we still consult with DSS. And again, we either handle those lawsuits internally or externally. We have Cooperative Extension, which is a program through North Carolina State University. And here's some of the numbers that they do through the Master Gardeners and do a lot of educational programs. We'll make sure we're a little bit behind when we get to the budget stuff. CECOM, here's the interesting thing about CECOM, about 12 to 18,000 calls per month. Half of them are emergency, half of them are not emergency. Sometimes people will call in a landline, that's not the 911 number, just for information. But again, between 12 and 18,000 calls a month. But we do it for everybody but Burlington. Let's see, whoops. And then the sheriffs, those are old figures. He forgot to give me the new figures, but he'll be here Thursday. Again, Board of Elections. Here's what I always thought was interesting. Here's how people are registered in Alamance County.
What does reform stand for?
There's a reform party.
Never heard of it.
That's the reason why there's zero in it.
Would you mind going back to that? I was talking. Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. There's a reason why there's zero.
Okay. Well, I don't know.
I don't know the reason.
Yeah, I've never heard of that before.
That's why they're too right.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. Again, then there's soil and water conservation. We do a lot in farmland preservation. In the voluntary ag district. Landfill. Most interesting thing about the landfill that I think you need to know, number one, we run it at a profit. About $855,000 annually. The reasoning for that is when we ever have to close the landfill, we have to expand the landfill, we have to do new equipment for the landfill. There's nothing cheap about a landfill. But it's not because we've raised the rates. Our rates have been at $36 per ton since 2002. But right now, we have about 75 years left on our landfill operations. But we're doing a lot of things with electronics and recycling, so you should be very proud of the work that's been done at the landfill.
Does that excess revenue just go into the general fund?
No, it specifically stays in the landfill. I wish it could go to the general fund, and we'll talk about the general fund, but no, it's an enterprise fund. So that's got to be still self-contained within the landfill. And there's a lot of pre- and post-closure issues, and we have an old landfill, but there's still some costs that we have to deal with. So that's where that money goes. So there's no general fund revenue that pays for the landfill. Please make sure you visit our website. A lot of different and interesting things on our website, from performance management, you have job openings, meeting information, minutes. And then if you're interested in serving on a committee, we have over 60 committees that we would love for you to volunteer on. There's a special section on that, or you can see Tori. She'll be glad to sign you up. But the next one I've got like 10 slides on the budget. Do you need a break, or do you want to go ahead and just go through it?
We're good.
Good, okay, all right.
Okay,
Such a...
It's about how much?
For 10 minutes.
Yeah.
No.
Maybe it's a
good one. We'll take care of that. Here's just a quick overview of what we do as far as the budget, and that's really one of the big things that everybody's concerned about. We follow rules that are outlined by the Local Government Commission, and that's a department of the state of North Carolina. We have the budget officer and his county manager statutorily. I serve as the budget officer. We have a finance officer. We have a tax collector. And the big thing to think about budget is our budget must be adopted by the Board of Commissioners before July 1 of each year. Again, we have to keep our funds separate. But these are some statutory requirements that we do have under the Budget Fiscal Control Act. All right, where do we get our money? County property taxes represent about 53%. Sales tax, 18%. We receive a lot of funding from the federal government and the state government, especially in our health department and social services. That's about 17.52%. Sales and service, the EMS fees or jail fees. License and permitting is when we charge for permits, like subdivision permits or inspection permits. So that's not a lot. And then investment earnings have not been good for the last 8 years. This is kind of a pie chart of our revenues. So we talked about our tax rate, 58 cent per 100 valuation. Again, on a $100,000 house, that's $580. So for $580, you help pay for all those services, plus schools, plus a community college, plus mental health that you didn't see. We talk reval as well. We also operate, again, we were talking earlier about our landfill. It's about a $3.69 million budget. But again, that's a separate budget. It's part of the overall, but we keep that money separate. And again, for fiscal year 2015-16, whoops, our total budget was about $138 million. Again, here's some of the categories and for education, debt service, general government, and this public safety. Let me go here first. Hopefully you can see it better at home. The biggest thing we spend our money, almost $40 million, is on education. So between the community college and ABSS, that's where the bulk of our money goes to, is for education. Next is social services. It says $24 million, but really county funding for that is about $5 million. Because the rest of it is federal grants or state grants. Then we have general government. Sheriff's Department's about $20.5 million. Debt service is almost $10 million. Really, for a county our size, a $10 million debt service is not a lot. Guilford County has about $1 billion in debt, or over $1 billion in debt, and I think our debt is 68 million. I think it's. I'll have to go back and check.
What is that debt? How did we incur that debt?
Schools. There's a school bond.
Capital.
Mostly capital. Okay. When we borrowed money for the courthouse and for facilities upgrades, that was about $10 million. We borrowed $10 million for the Career Tech High School. So those were recent things. We borrowed $5 million for 800 megahertz changeover in our communications. So just kind of added up. But overall, our per capita debt's really very low. Then it goes public safety or other public safety, which is fire marshal, emergency management, libraries, other spending, and recreation. here's something that I think is important and hope that you will be a part of, is our budget process. We recently had a board, this is about a month later than we normally like to do things. We had a recent retirement of Dan Engel and from our board, so it's kind of thrown us off kilter a little bit on timing. But hopefully we will have a new board member by the first part of May. So in mid-May, we'll have budget workshops, and they'll be in the afternoon. Beginning around 2 in the afternoon, 2 about 4, that we will meet with every department, every nonprofit, every outside agency, and they'll come in and get to make their budget presentation to the board. And then on June 6th, after the budget workshops, I'll compile that information, make the cuts that I would recommend as county manager, and give it to the Board of Commissioners for their consideration on June 6th. And then we will be looking at a public hearing, and that's an opportunity for you to come and tell us what you think. You like it, you dislike it, cut taxes, raise taxes, spend money on more on schools, don't spend money on schools. That'll be June 20th, and at that time they can adopt the budget. They don't have to. But they need to do it before July 1, or you have to do a continuation budget. Because July 1 is when our fiscal year begins. And then it'll end June 30 of 2017. Again, all these meetings will be open to the public. They'll be on our website. They'll be in the paper. We would encourage you to come, question. Commissioner's Bird, email address is bob.bird@almaz-nc.com, but all over on the website. So if you have questions or concerns, please let Bob know. Yes, sir.
Is there a federal law that mandates cities and counties assist nonprofits?
No, sir. Most of the times it's historical. And nonprofits can ask. Each community is a little bit different. I've worked for communities that didn't, and we do. And basically the ones we do are just kind of been historical in nature of what we've always done.
Well, I mean, there must be hundreds in mm-hmm. the county.
Thousands.
So how do we decide who gets help and who doesn't?
We have not, and that's a great question. We have not gone through a process of either opening it up, because we're getting nonprofits asked the question all the time. Off the top of my head, we fund like the Sword of Peace. We fund the North Carolina Symphony. We fund Meals on Wheels. We fund...
See, if I managed one of those, I would be embarrassed to go to the government mm-hmm. and ask for help.
Yeah.
Because it defeats the definition of a nonprofit, which is funded by churches, individuals, possibly corporations. And I got an answer from the city of Burlington that said there is a federal law that mandates it related to housing.
Housing, yes. But for Sword of Peace and Alamance Museum, that we've always funded, that have been, it's just kind of been what we always said. Bob, I wish I don't have a better answer.
Well, I would say this is that nonprofits, a lot of them, and I've been on boards of nonprofits that get some funding from the county, and it would be very difficult to operate those without that funding.
Yeah.
That's one thing. Another thing, it would be very difficult to operate those organizations without the county's contribution. Alamance Eldercare is a good example.
Yeah.
And oftentimes what the nonprofits are providing services that if they didn't exist, the burden of dealing with whatever issues those agencies are dealing with would probably fall to government. And, you know, like Alamance Eldercare was created out of this, I can't think of her name from Swepsonville. Mm-hmm. She's the chairman of the Alamance Committee on Services for the Elderly. And 20 years ago, that group met to look at the community and what was needed, and that formed the creation of Alamance Elder Care, because that the services that they provided were just really needed. You can argue one way or the other. Yeah. And I would say that the total amount of the county's budget that goes to nonprofit agencies is very minuscule.
It is. I think it's under $100,000. Yes, sir.
On one of your slides, you said like 54% of the county's budget or something like that came from property taxes?
Yes.
Any rough estimate how much is of that 50-some percent is residential and how much is?
I can probably find that out, but I'd have to go back to our tax administrator and check.
Would it be legal to have one tax rate for businesses? So it's got to be across the board.
That's a good question. I asked that when I got on the board.
Well, I just wondered because you hear retired people talk about their costs go up and they get priced out of their house by tax rates and stuff like that. I was just wondering if you could put something like at age 60, whatever.
There is programs. There's the homestead exemption.
Yeah.
Senior citizens exclusion that you can apply for.
Yeah, but it's, you have to be, well, I just know I looked at it for my father.
Yeah.
And he didn't qualify.
Yeah.
And I mean, he's not sitting on a pile of money, you know, 6 foot tall or whatever. So that's why I was wondering if you could cap at a certain rate, at a certain age or whatever.
Those exceptions are really the only thing that they do offer. Again, it's 316, and I apologize for keeping you late. Didn't know how long this would take or not take. Thank you for being the guinea pigs for this. We have your email address and evaluation. If you want to tell us what we can do better, again, we're going to do some things a little bit different on Thursday. Hope you come back. But if there's more information you need or less information you need, let me know. We want to make sure that this is value added to you. Again, I thank Commissioner Bird for being here. I thank Tori for the work she did in setting this up. And again, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
What's the budget?